Hey, it's Fedora. Welcome back to Disgaea 4. So, last time we learned what the prinny rule number 1 is, and now we're in Hades, where we're just gonna do a little bit of touring around. Nothing's really open at this point. And the village shop will give you extra powerful traits. The item roll does self-explain. It will be explained later on. Campaign manager will explain later on. DLC shop, if you want to get items and stuff, we're not gonna use them. The nurse who's gonna heal you, because after every battle, you don't automatically heal. You have to pay money to heal back up, but it's usually very cheap. And if you have a prinny that's down for the count, it only costs like one hell, which basically is like paying 1 cent for her that to be repaired. And we also have NPCs around. So, got shops. You have a data shop here, memory shops, sort of keeping track of what's going on in the game. Ranking shops, online stuff. General store. I'll explain most of the stuff when it comes relevant. For right now, we just chat with some of the NPCs and pick up some more items. That is an Aragi, a mushroom monster. And as you see, Fenric was offended. We also have Cleopatra here, a Nekomata. I could arrange to see if Izzy ever plays Disgaea game, this will be his favorite class. Kung Fu Cats. Exactly. They're also very good. I use them frequently. I always have one in my party. But you usually don't come across one for a while. Gargoyle. He still is stumbling down the fact that sardines provide more than enough nutrition, but the reality is the opposite. Sardines aren't human. True. 100 hell, gives us 100 currency, and we have a cockatrice convict here. You know, for a jail, I can walk in and out pretty easily. And of course we have ourselves a pretty here. Dude. Under our printing instructor. So yeah, we got a bunch of... These are going to be a bunch of classes you're going to come across later on. And an Alron. Once again, another monster class. The effeminate-looking male flower demon. Yes, they are male. And we also get ABC gum. That's right, ABC gum. Some of the item descriptions are pretty cool too. We have sardines. You're lucky. You'll be lucky if the open soda's not flat, indeed. And you also have, you see, you also have rarities there. The lower that number is, the more rare the item is. So you have common, you have rare, and you have kind of like mythical or legendary. So. Recovers HP. Next time, won't you chew with me? Yes, chew with ABC gum, the most generic gum ever made. Also, slime. Another monster. These monsters are actually extremely powerful against physical attacks, but against magic, they are complete liabilities. Anyway, that's enough of that. It's time to actually go and do something. So, let's go to the dimension guide. Here is our dimension portal right here. In Disgaea 2, you can actually see what level it is, and it's something like 1,458. Complete the zone HP bar and everything. Anyway, here we go. Basic controls and stuff. Well, I'm gonna basically do all the explaining.
After death, the souls of human subjects are sent to Hades. When they arrive in Hades, the Netherworld's prison, they are processed to become prinnies at the Prinny Factory. The prinnies go through extensive training in Hades before being sent off to the Netherworld or Celestia. They are to work diligently in a strict and harsh environment until they can pay for their sins.
Remember, the prinnies are not victims, they are actually bad sinners. They are pretty low people. in their previous life.
Yes, sir!
Even though they're kind of mascots now.
Excellent. Now listen up, prinnies. Today is your very last day in Hades. You have all died and were sent to Hades. Why is that?
Because we committed crimes, dude!
He sounds so excited when they say that.
That's right. You're lowly criminals. And who educated you, peons? Who didn't even know how to speak like a prinny?
Lord Valvatores, dude!
Correct! I've raised you all to become great prinnies, so that you can be shipped out to the netherworld at any time. Today is the day you've been waiting for. Today, you will go forth and work hard to pay for your sins.
Yes, they're graduating. As weird as it sounds. The very last tutorial. Press Y if you're confident enough. Well, I am, actually. So listen very carefully. I'm gonna definitely skip. Because we're gonna do this the way it needs to be done, with me. So, as you see, this is a standard, this is a very small map. We have four prinnies here, dude, named Shabazz, Paul, Pachi, and Ramza. Wow. I remember him from Final Fantasy Tactics. What crimes did he commit? The crime of causing many gamers to burn out? That's why I stopped playing Final Fantasy Tactics once upon a time. Anyway. So you start with the base panel here. You can deploy up to 10 units at a time if you, and if they're wounded, you can actually bring them back.
Here I come.
So, well, I can actually do this and say, you know, screw it, I don't want to bring Valvatores out, I'll bring him back. And I can reset and bring someone else out in his place. If you lose somebody in battle, though, you can't do this. So, let's start with Valvatores.
I'll teach you a lesson.
And you can move around, you also have specials, HP and SP, self-explanatory there. You see all the stats. I'll explain the stats below, the 5, the 20, the 1 in detail later on. You also have affinities. So, in Valvatore's example, he is actually very resistant to ice, but he's a little more vulnerable to fire. Something to consider. So you gotta watch out for magic attacks. So, you can move around, and if I don't like where I'm moving, I can say screw it, I'll move somewhere else. So there is that. I can attack, I can defend, basically to reduce damage. I don't really do that ever. I can use specials. Valvatores, being a unique unit, will have his own special moves. But, with all that said and done, let's move in front of this prinny, and let's strike. As you see, we have a red bar there that represents Shamaz's HP, and a yellow bar which would project the damage we do. The 99% might as well be 100. It never goes to 100. I think maybe in very unique situations, but you really don't have to worry. But I don't want to attack from the front, I want to attack from the side. I do a little more damage. But, unique to this game, and unlike a Fire Emblem, normally when you move a character, you're prompted to then attack or wait or go on standby or do whatever. Not so here. The object of Disgaea, really, Fenric has a little movement, so we're going to get right behind this guy. Is we can do more damage from the back. So we can actually stack our attacks up and just dogpile on an enemy as we damn well please. But we're not going to just do that.
I got this.
I got other things I want to do here. So Jose is going to move there. The Sardine Thief is not going to move here. The Illest. Yes, the Illest.
I'm going to do it.
We'll use fire. Our attack ramps it right there. Now, why am I doing this and not actually attacking one by one? Well, the higher your combo, the more attacks you chain, even if it's on different enemies, the higher your combo gets. The higher your combo gets, the more damage you do. The higher damage you do, the better off it is for you. And also, the bonus meter that you see there goes up faster too. So it's actually much more advantageous to you to say, get all your attacks lined up, and then execute all at once, then just do one, execute, one, execute, one, execute, one, execute. It doesn't work.
Forgive me.
Gina, just park your butt over here. And, you can attack Ramza, too.
Pretty commando!
Pretty commando, dude! Actually, no, I'm gonna have Gina attack. this. So that's kind of how this works. You can attack your allies too, no point doing it, obviously. Also, too, if you have characters like this next to each other, next to the character who's attacking, not next to the enemy, you can sometimes get combo attacks off, which do a lot more damage. So, once you're done, you hit execute, or end turn, either one. And because Gina's right next to Valvatoris, she's going to join in his attack, which will do slightly more damage. And it turns out the Cat Saber wants to help Fenrir out. And now my fire attack does pretty good damage. The pretty's pretty genocide. And voila! It also seems like I did not use Jose, so I need to fix that. 92% chance means it's not a guaranteed hit, but it's still worth it. And I'm gonna have three people attacking this one, doing even more damage. Complete with the over-the-top attack animations. And oh my, we got a crit there. Yes, you can get randomly a crit, usually depending on you having a high chance to attack. You can also have something called a nick, kind of like a grazing. If you have low enough accuracy, if your accuracy is too low, you may do like half damage, or you may miss altogether. Sucks either way. But we're done, so let's end the turn and let the other pretty have his turn. Pretty dude. But let's not waste time here. Let's use a skill. Avatares, Impaler Prince, please. Be careful not to hit your own guy. That would not be good.
I'll show you.
There we go, the Impaler Prince.
Sardines!
There.
Yes, he did scream sardines when he did that. Avatares loves the sardines. And there you go. So what do we do? By chaining as many attacks as we could off, we actually raised our bonus point up to the point where we're getting 30 hell extra on top of destroying enemies and getting 144, and we're also getting a little free experience on the side. You want to raise that bonus as high as you can, because you can get some really good stuff later on. It's kind of impossible for right now, but later on, down the road, you'll want to. And with that, that's the tutorial. Most of these tutorials are very tongue-in-cheek. In the first one, they kind of show you what not to do, so the vassal, who kind of just likes to pull the chain of the lord, controls the lord, puts him into a very unwinnable situation, he gets his ass kicked. This is what the hell is that about? This is an example of what you're not supposed to do. In Disgaea, strategy is kind of a loose term here. The real strategy is this. Hit extreme, dogpile an enemy and hit hard as you can. They go to the next guy and do it again. And the next one. And the next one. That really is all the strategy is. To call it strategy is not really strategy. It's actually the simplest form of strategy. But that's what makes it fun. You can cause some catastrophic amounts of damage. And you'll need to do that. And you can chain attacks in certain ways to do more damage and stuff. But normally, if you're having trouble with an enemy, the only solution is this. Level up. Seriously. So, now we got Rosin Queen up, and we got money. So, if we go to Rosin Queen, let's go to the nurse first. And she'll heal my damage, which is good. So, I believe one person took damage. It looks like they're not going to count the damage I took, so we would get treated. Depending on the amount of HP and SP that gets replenished, and also if you have to revive people from the dead, you'll actually be able to claim prizes. So things like giving more HP, better weaponry, better buffs in general. So yes, the infirmary is going to be something you visit frequently. We have the weapon shop here, Rosin Queen Company. And giving you a little explanation on the weapons here. There are several types of weapons, and usually, characters are good at one or two types of them. and there's other differences associated, you know, distance, things like that. Starting with our friend here, Fenric, because he's a fisticuff user, we can acquire scary weapons such as oven mitts, old gloves, or toy puppets. You could also get for Valvatoris paring knives. Now, you can really equip anybody with any type of weapon, except for monsters, they have their own special type, but the truth is you don't want to do this. So let's get a paring knife for Valvatoris. So, Valvatoris right here. Actually, let me show that off, just to illustrate my point. Pretty sure they should have something here. I know they have something here for this, I just need to remember how to get to it. He has a paring knife already, so never mind then. Ah. So here we are. Yeah, in this game, unlike some of the other games where you could freely equip like anybody with anything, here you have weapon fortes here, so Valvatoris can get a sword or a spear, Fenric a fist or an axe, Jose the fighter can go sword, spear, or axe, the Red Skull, staff, the healer, a bow or staff, and then the monsters have their own unique thing. So, let's go and buy ourselves some stuff. So I'm gonna go and you can try the item, which will show you what you have. As you see, weapons have their own properties. They can give you more HP, they give you more attack, they give you more speed, defense, resist, whatever. And you also see what Dietitian and Gladiator are, those will be explained later on. And you also see on the left, Aptitude. Aptitudes are kind of like your multipliers. So this old gloves here, for example, would give me 10 speed. Fenric has a speed multiplier of 130%. So if he equips this, his speed would go up overall by 13 compared to what he has equipped. The oven mitts, it would be, let's say, like 6. So, the general term is this. If your weapons have certain attributes to them, you want to make sure that they coincide with the aptitudes. So, if somebody has an aptitude like 50% on a weapon, you don't want to equip that weapon. You probably want to go something else. So, in the case of the old gloves here, the fist will give Fenric better attack and also improve speed. But if I gave him like a... if I tried to give him a staff or something, I wouldn't do it. His intelligence or resistance boost would be lower than what they should. That's kind of what I'm trying to say. In the case of Gina right here, the bow will give her a little bit extra hit power, but not much. And then Jose's kind of like strength, and so on and so forth. Jose, as you see, has got good strength, good attack, good defense, and they'll be boosted with whatever weapon I have. But if a weapon has speed boost, like say the fists, it won't work. It won't work very well for him. So that's kind of the examples here. Anyway, let's talk about the weapons, shall we? The fist. Fists use a combination of attack and speed to determine power. So, as such, oven mitts like this will actually increase both. The sword standard, just your basic weapon, raises your attack, and that really is all it's going to do. A spear allows you to attack from two tiles away to help you out by attacking without repercussions, and usually increases your defense a little bit. It doesn't have as good attack, though, so that's something to keep in mind. Bows use attack and hit to determine firepower, so as you see, the attack and hit would increase based on equipping a bow. A gun uses hit and speed, so if I have a gun equipped, I could go and use the power for that. Don't do what I did in the beginning and think that attack was the end-all be-all. because attack has no effect on gun power. Just hit in speed. How speed plays in this, I have no idea. Axe. Pure attack. Staff usually uses intelligence, not attack. You can melee with a staff, but you really shouldn't do it. You should use it for magic attacks like fire. And then this is a monster class weapon right here. This thing right here, well, it's more of a physical type. You also have a monster emblem type. These are more intelligence based. We don't have anything like that. We have prinnies. So we'd want to give them sardine bones, paw gloves, and things like that. You can equip one weapon, and you can also equip three types of armor, accessories, and the like. So, and yes, the weapon selections change each time, so if you use up all the weapons, you don't like what you see, exit, come back. So I can get vinyl cloths for everybody if I wish. I can get pot lids, too. Give myself a little more defense. An evil election sash. Don't forget to wear this during your speech. Oh, God. So, right now, Valtoris has a vinyl cloth, so he has a little bit of armor, an Imperial Seal, which is kind of like a all-around stat-up. Not a very powerful one, but one nonetheless. Fenrir comes with slippers, which gives him an extra towel to move, and a little more speed. You also get other things like glasses to improve your hit rate, and things like that. But we're going to go get potlets for people. Help themselves out. And since I'm done with the pot lids, let's get out of here. Let's go back. And as you see, we got more to pick from. See? So you always have stuff to choose. And with three armor slots, really, you can customize them pretty good. You can really specialize them. Now, Potlet has a defense of 9, but as you see from the Red Skull here, the defense aptitude is 80. So, he only is going to gain 7 defense from this. That's important to note. You know, little things like that you'll be aware of later on. And so that's that, pretty much. General Store will give you items. Items you can use pretty much whenever in battle. So I can increase my SP or my HP, you know, getting mint gum, things like that. Spearmint is the most violent mint flavor. Remember that next time. Hard candy, straight for your grandma's coffee table. Boy, I can relate to that one. Elvish rolls up vampires won't bless. Garlic water, fairy dust. Fairy dust is good, it cures ailments. You also get experience potions here, so you can get a little more experience. Stealing hands, because you can actually steal items in Disgaea games, although this is probably the hardest to do it in, to start, etc., etc. Let's see here, there should be a way to actually, sort. Maybe not. It's fine. I'll explain more about the weapons when they become more relevant, because right now it's not. And are some of these other things open? Nope, they're not. So, let's go forward into the next area. You didn't realize I didn't take any damage, right? Or the game gave it back to me. Come on, the sardines aren't that good. Special skill and defense. A nerd tutorial. I'll let this one play out, because I think it could be worth it. There are character skills and weapon skills. Weapon skills are learned by equipping a certain type of weapon, as long as you're forte. And you can learn specialized moves just by using the weapon frequently and having your rank go up. Character skills are kind of like the impaler thing I used before with Valtoris.
Take this!
Mr. Gentleheart?
I'll show you!
Oh my god, why am I getting caravan vibes out of that?
Sardines!
By the power of sardines. So unlike normal types, you can't activate team attacks or special skills, but you can still create pretty nasty combos with them. And now, as far as defense is concerned... I rarely use defense, truth be told.
Here I come!
Because I prefer attacking more. But let's watch this. I rarely, if ever, do that. Will my defense range get bigger if I try to... Okay, Prinny. Alright. So, that's kind of how it works.
Perish!
So I'll use Fenric instead. Oh, Fenric doesn't have one, apparently.
I'll teach you a lesson!
But Valvatoris does, so... We'll just do a little chained thing here. And that should be enough to take care of that Bob Ganoush.
Time to bust some balls!
Oh my.
Ha!
The mage only knows it. The healer only knows a heal at this time. Illus, as we saw, knows fire. And the Sardine Thief does no shit. And of course... And of course, prinnies don't know anything either, because they're prinnies. They're just there to look like idiots.
Let's don't go, Raiders!
Sardines!
Get used to hearing sardines a lot.
I'll teach you what I think.
It's a love potion.
Sardines!
I think.
But we got rid of him, so that's good. And now, let's just defend with everybody else, because we can. That's the only reason why, because this is a tutorial, I'll forget to do this later on, or I'll be too lazy. But not right now. Okay, pretty dudes. It's nice that Fenric's actually very quick. And, oh, he can counter too. Certain characters have the ability to counterattack. Fenric is one of them. Actually, all of them have the capability, but certain ones who are more physically inclined, like Fenric, will do it more. So, that's kind of what happened there. The ability shop, we'll see that later on. You get to pay with mana, which you get from defeating enemies. Allowing you to pick more abilities later on. So, at current, we actually have abilities equipped on everybody. Kind of default to the class, or default to the unique character. But you see, you can learn others. So, just to show it off briefly, Valvatoris has Bloody Battle, so his attack goes up by the number of defeated enemies by 5%. Fenric's stats go up when next to Valvatoris. Jose will go and get stronger based on the number of adjacent enemy units there are. The mage, by default, does more damage, but uses more SP. And the healer's power gets stronger based on the number of adjacent units there are. Monster-type units don't damage cat sabers as well. And the prinny will explode when thrown. That's right. That's what makes the prinnies prinnies. They are the ultimate expendable unit. They can they're like hand grenades that can melee. Or the Final Fantasy enemy bomb, which could melee you and then explode on you. Of course, that means they're out of battle afterwards. So here's the ability shop. And we could also learn skills as well as abilities. So abilities, which Fenric showed, gives you better aptitudes. Aptitudes are your multipliers, once again. You also get more resistance, base HP going up, SP, base stats going up in general. Vaccines to make you more resistant to certain status ailments, which will become relevant later on. Or better team attack chances. Another thing you can do is you can also learn skills and boost skills. So, Fenric, Valtoris, because I'm using a sword with him, I can have him learn Blade Rush. So, it's a sword-based attack to help him out. And, if I want, I can try boosting the skill. It'll make it more powerful, but also it costs a little more SP each time, so you might want to watch it. So, that's kind of how it works. Fenric, I'll have him learn Triple Strike, because I'm going to have him be a melee wielder. There's usually one melee type in every army, so, in this game. So I can boost the Triple Strike, and so on and so forth. So, as time goes on, we can learn more skills, become more complete in our firepower. And learn skills that have more power to them, and eliminate certain enemies, and create more combos in certain enemies, because maybe something attacks with three spaces away, or something like that, for example. So, just little things like that. Anyway, that's enough for this part. So, we'll continue on with the tutorials next time. Hopefully, we'll actually get to doing, the story-based stuff. Anyway, I'll see you guys later before we're signing off.